For all of the excitement and enthusiasm around autonomous vehicles over the last decade, on the whole, we aren't quite there yet. Nevertheless, the foundational technologies required are developing apace. I've been invited today to the National Automotive Innovation Centre here at WMG University of Warwick to find out more about one of those foundational technologies required for autonomous vehicles and a whole lot more besides, PNT, positioning, navigation, and timing.
Alex, introduce yourself and tell us a bit about your work here.
Yeah, so my name's Alex Gayfield and I am currently a PhD researcher at WMG, the University of Warwick. Previously before that, I was in the Royal Air Force as an avionics technician, where I worked on military aircraft, including the F-35B.
Wow.
And I worked on anything involving anything from a light bulb to the wiring in between to, of course, the PNT systems.
Right. Okay, so PNT systems, this is positioning, navigation, and timing. And this all fits into your area of research here, doesn't it?
Yes, so my area of research is assured PNT. Mm-hmm. And what we're looking at, so specifically the manufacturing or industrial environments of the future, where you have a lot of autonomous and connected systems. And what we're trying to do is to give you an assured level of positioning and timing information that meet the required level of accuracy and precision in edge cases, which can be quite difficult to do in different environments.
Sure, so let me get this right. If you're on a factory floor and you've got these AGVs, these autonomous guided vehicles, self-driving robots basically, whatever it is they're doing, having the positioning accurate for those both on the factory floor, if that's inside, but then also outside, is really, really important. And there are some specific challenges with that kind of environment as well, aren't there?
Yeah, there's quite a few specific challenges, especially in these edge cases that we're dealing with. And to be honest, for these systems to operate properly, the most important thing for them to know is to know exactly when and where they are at all times. Otherwise, it can't really work as well as you'd want it to.
Super. Now, tell me about the role that Spirent plays in your work and as a sponsor, as a partner?
Yeah, so Spirent are really quite invested into my PhD and my research. Mm-hmm. I'm very fortunate to have them. So obviously we have access to some of their devices that allow us to simulate, which is quite a huge boost for me because it creates these very controlled and recreatable scenarios that you can't really do every day. And then also what's really probably one of the best benefits is I have access to their team who are experts in their field but also very in tune into what industry wants and needs. So that allows me to hone my research down to what industry needs, giving me more impact with my research.
Now, you mentioned the testing there. Just talk to me about this room that we're in right now where you are able to do your testing, because it's quite a special room, I'm not going to lie. There's not very much of an echo in here, and that's no coincidence.
Yeah, so we are in an anechoic chamber. Mm-hmm. So this is really important, especially when you come to GNSS. So these signals you can't broadcast out into the real world, mainly because it could be dangerous.
Yeah.
So in these chambers, it doesn't allow the signals we broadcast to go outside or other signals to come inside,
yeah,
which give us that real opportunity to create some scenarios with the Spirent equipment that you can't do outside.
So essentially with the systems, the testing systems that you have here from Spirent, you are creating a pretend location. This could be anywhere on the planet right now. And you're able then to test the equipment, the AGV that you mentioned there. So there's a car here in front of us as well. And test that they are where the software, where the hardware tells them that they are. And you don't want those signals leaking out to the outside world, because that could be dangerous.
Exactly right, exactly right. And that's the real benefit of having this room and this equipment, so we can do that. And not only where we are, but also when we are as well, because the timing plays a key aspect into this.
Now, you've got this rich background working in the Royal Air Force, working with some of the most incredible engineering and machinery in the world. You've made a bit of a pivot here to be working with your feet firmly on the ground. What excites you most about this area of work that you're engaged in right now, this area of research, and hopefully seeing it come to the real world?
I think what's really interesting is it's quite fast moving, and you'd probably raise an eyebrow thinking, come from the military, but actually every day there's something new kind of coming on, there's a new challenge going on. I think PNT is probably one of the fastest moving research fields going.
Yeah.
And it's exciting. It's exciting to see what challenges there are, and there's always new opportunities for research and what to work on.
And as we look towards the future and the research that you're engaged in here right now, coming to the real world, what kind of difference do you think that's going to make? You mentioned an industrial kind of factory floor scenario there with the AGVs. Is also this area of research potentially likely to impact me as I drive around or even be flown around various parts of the world?
Exactly right. The whole research field is quite broad, and yes, we're working on a specific example, but they all translate to different areas. And in fact, this is one of, they call it the hidden utility, because we use it in everything we do every day. It's not just our GPS on our phones. It's embedded into the financial sector. The timing information is really important for synchronizing. And it's just one of those things that as a modern society, we can't operate without. It's almost like the electricity that runs through all our systems.
Cool. Alex, thank you so much for chatting us through that. It's a fascinating area of work. And well, it's been great to see some of it in action in here today.
Cool, my pleasure. Thank you.
So I'm Dr. Rafael Grack, a technical strategist for PNT, position, navigation and timing at Spirent. I tend to look primarily at emerging technologies, as in what's coming next. And I work very closely with a good number of universities in the UK and worldwide.
Talk to me about some of the applications then for PNT technology. Obviously, I know the blue dot on my phone that helps me get to the shops or to the theatre or whatever, but where else does it tend to be used?
Yeah, so it's used across a good number of sectors, and that's including the finance sector, the energy sector.
Finance sector?
Yeah, so things that you wouldn't even think of. So with PNT, T is for timing.
Right.
So when you're doing a financial transaction, you need to make sure that if I send you the money now, or you do a stock market exchange or something, my time has to be exactly as your time. And if we are not synchronized, then the transaction would fall apart. So GNSS, or the Global Navigation Satellite System,
which is GPS and GLONASS, it's all of those different constellations, all
correct.
Kind of a generic term.
Correct.
For them all.
What they provide you, in its essence, it's not the position. They provide you the time.
Right.
So my time is the same as your time because we're receiving the same signal and we can do the transaction. The position comes as a second element to that. So you have a good number of satellites that when you do some clever mathematics with them, you get exactly where you are. But GNSS is just one element. There are other technologies which are also related to position, navigation and timing. So sensors, inertial and things of the like.
Yeah. So in terms of applications there, you mentioned, say, Google Maps, other mapping services are available, financial services, the T there. Who else, what are the sort of sectors, what other industries really benefit from accurate PNT systems?
Yeah, so it's used across ranging from military and defense, government, the energy sector, finance, aviation, maritime, you name it, handheld devices. It's ubiquitous, it's everywhere.
Gosh, it really is, isn't it?
We are seeing, for example, a big increase in precision agriculture.
Right.
So some of the activities which are happening there is leading companies in the agriculture are trying to track every granule, every grain, from the time it was sowed up until harvest.
Right.
So for that you need very precise positioning, very accurate monitoring, and that all ties into PNT.
And of course we see a real growth towards more autonomy, more automation, particularly in the industrial sector, agriculture being one of those, manufacturing as well, and accurate positioning and navigation is absolutely crucial when you don't have a human at the wheel or at the joystick necessarily.
Correct. Yeah. So something which GNSS on its own doesn't have is the situational awareness. So when you're driving down the road, you know where you are and you can tie the position that you're seeing on the screen with what you're seeing around you. However, if you're just relying blindly on that dot, which we spoke about earlier, if that dot is not where you are, then that becomes an issue, a safety concern.
Yes.
So that, together with the other technologies, which we are currently part of, if you remove the human from the system, you need to make sure that you are replacing them with something which is resilient, which is accurate, and which is robust to interference.
And of course, there's a lot of research and development that you are doing in this area. Talk to me a bit about your research and development efforts. You do a lot in-house at Spirent, but you also partner with academic institutions as well.
Correct. Yeah. So in terms of the GNSS testing, in terms of the GNSS research and development, we do a fair amount in-house. Mm-hmm. However, as a technology, we are not just helping our customers to innovate faster, we are also pushing the boundaries of PNT. And in order to do that, you need to work with the best and the brightest, and those are the academics and people working in universities. So with WMG, we've been working with them for a good number of years now. Mm-hmm. We provide them with equipment. We also get our engineers to work with the researchers here. Uh-huh. And we also support the research community and the research, the students, the PhD students, to make sure that we have the next generation of engineers and scientists coming into the PNT who are experts in the field. For us, this is extremely important because the technology is always evolving. Our customers are at the leading edge. They are some of the brightest institutions who are developing PNT technologies. And for us to keep up and stay ahead of the technology so that we can actually help them, we need to make sure that we are part of the community who is not just delivering the existing technologies, but we are also pushing the boundaries.
And then from Spirent's point of view, Raf, with the technology, with the capabilities that you provide in terms of your testing platforms, your testing hardware, what are the benefits of collaborations like this and the outcomes for your customers?
Yeah, so first and foremost, in terms of the benefit, it's the benefit for the whole community, because if the technology is moving forward, everyone is going to benefit. Yeah. For our customers specifically, they have the assurance that we are in line with them. We are working with them to make sure that whatever technology they are developing, we are also developing the testing capability for them to make sure that whatever is being developed is properly tested, it's properly validated, and we are working with them to make sure that the customer is and has the trust that whatever is being developed has the assurance that it needs.
That's what it's about at the end of the day, the assurance, the trust. These systems need to be accurate. You need to understand how accurate they are in order for you to trust whether it's a driverless car or whether it's a self-driving robot around a factory or whether it's me just getting to the theatre on time. We all need to trust this technology, these blue dots.
Correct.
Raf, this sounds like a really fascinating area of innovation and research. How can people, maybe academics, find out more and maybe engage with you in some way?
Yeah, so that is really simple. We have an academia program with a range of different opportunities. Mm-hmm. And yeah, we'd love to hear from you.
So I'm Matthew Higgins. I'm an academic here at WMG University of Warwick. We are standing inside one of the High Valley Manufacturing Catapult Laboratories. Mm-hmm. And our research and the research team around us is essentially trying to understand both the fundamental and applied aspects of most of the technologies that you'll find in everyday life. So we're talking about 4G, 5G, what would soon to be 6G. But more importantly at the moment, we're talking about position, navigation and timing technologies, otherwise known as PNT.
And this area of technology is important. Why? How do these technologies manifest themselves in our everyday lives?
So from our perspective as a university, what we're trying to do is go beyond just quantifying a technical specification or mm-hmm. a technical ability of some technology and actually see how it impacts our daily lives. So for example, on the vehicle side or the automotive side, what we are concerned about is not just its resolution or its ability to look at a location per meter or how resilient it is, but how that actually translates to the vehicle becoming part of a system, part of a transport system that is potentially greener or it is potentially safer.
And this is where that word impact comes in, and that's really important in your philosophy, I guess, or at least why you do what you do.
Absolutely. So it's very important that sometimes you go beyond just technologies for technology's sake.
Yes.
And then we have to actually look at how that translates into a benefit for the worker, for the person, for the society, or for the country as a whole. So again, I can bring it back to the automotive side, that we need to care about the transport network as a whole. But on the manufacturing side, for example, we might be looking at how automated guided vehicles or AGVs assist a worker or assist a factory worker or assist delivery. And whilst the technology can be very good, and whilst it can be very safe and resilient, what it doesn't always translate to quite readily is how that impacts the productivity of the factory, how that saves the worker from having backs, aches and sprains, for example. And that is the impact that we need to look at.
Value, I guess, might be another way of thinking of that impact piece.
Exactly. We need to look at the ongoing benefit to society from that technology being taken from a wonderful fundamental level all the way to being applied.
And that helps you to ensure that you're focusing on the right pieces of research, the right innovations. Another word that I want to understand more about what it means to you is trust. Why is trust so important?
So trust is about the pace of adoption of technology, is a way to define it that in that perspective. So whilst we can have very good technology, if it does not find its way to market quickly, it has little benefit. If the users trust it, so for example, if a factory worker trusts that the AGV will bring them raw materials mm-hmm. or components safely, quickly, and in the correct manner, they will trust that technology to improve their own productivity, which as a larger factory or a larger ecosystem of industry increases the UK's productivity. But that's all related to how quickly workers, factories are willing to adopt that technology.
So trust is kind of the catalyst. Once you've proven the value, the impact of a technology, trust is the catalyst to see that scale and really return that value that you've identified.
Correct. As the technology interacts more with the human, we have to have this kind of symbiotic trust that one and the other helps each other rather than trying to compete with each other.
Speaking of symbiotic trust, talk to me about the importance of the partnerships that you have here with industry partners, Spirent, for example.
So as a university, we deal to a very broad base of potential partners. So we deal with a lot of SMEs, we deal with mid-sized and larger companies. And quite often they come to us with questions that are related to maybe their technology or their understanding of technology. And our role, I guess, in that technology readiness level, as we take the technologies from the fundamentals to the applied that has this impact, is that we need to often do some quantification or qualification of that technology. And partners such as Spirent help us along that pathway. They help us accelerate our testing, our ability to look at technologies, to provide the end users, in our cases the SMEs, with a better understanding of how that technology will be trusted in their system.
Trust, impact, value was the one that I threw in there. It's a fascinating story. Matt, thank you so much for chatting us through that.
Thank you.